There you go. For as many of you were baptized into Christ, have clothed yourselves with Christ. In his baptism, Allendale Verhey was clothed with Christ. In the day of Christ's coming, he will be clothed with glory.
When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with Christ in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his.
Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth.
I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die.
I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever. Because I live, so also you will live.
Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest.
God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear.
The eternal God is your dwelling place, and underneath are the everlasting arms.
As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear God. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you, says the Lord.
Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my victorious right hand.
If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's.
Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom.
Praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord all my life.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, you formed us from the dust of the earth, and by your breath you gave us life. We glorify you. Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, you tasted death for all humanity, and by rising from the grave, you opened the way to eternal life. We praise you. Holy Spirit, author and giver of life, you are the comforter of all who sorrow, our sure confidence and everlasting hope. We worship you. To you, O Blessed Trinity, be glory and honor forever and ever. Amen. Our Old Testament lesson is taken from Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me, from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our ancestors trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will pay before those who fear him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. The word of the Lord. What do you understand by the providence of God? The Almighty, whereby he still holds, as it were by his own hand, heaven and earth together with all creatures, and rules in such a way that leaves and grass, rain and drought, fruitful and unfruitful years, food and drink, health and sickness, riches and poverty, and everything else come to us not by chance, but by his heavenly hand.
Thank you. 21st chapter of the book of Revelation. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I'm making all things new." Also he said this, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end." This is the word of the Lord. Would you join me now in the words of the Heidelberg Catechism? What advantage comes from acknowledging God's creation and providence? We learn that we are to be patient in adversity, grateful in the midst of blessing, and to trust our faithful God and Father for the future, assured that no creature shall separate us from his love, since all creatures are so completely in his hand that without his will they cannot even move. Please join me in prayer. O Lord, we come to you this day in grief and in gratitude. May our grief and our gratitude and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Patient in adversity, grateful in the midst of blessing, trusting our faithful God and Father for the future, assured that no creature shall separate us from his love. The life of our friend Alan Verhey fully and faithfully embodied these words of the Heidelberg Catechism. Indeed, the example of Alan's life and death causes a ray of illumination to fall across this venerable confession of faith. After hearing the news of Alan's death, one of his doctoral students, Matt Jansen, wrote this to a circle of friends. Alan was well known for saying that the Christian life ought to be lived in memory of Jesus. I hope he would not begrudge us for adding that we who are left behind in his absence will also now live our lives in memory of Alan. No doubt Matt is right, but I wonder, would Alan, in fact, approve? Of course, Alan would not have wanted himself to be the focal point of attention. Like John the Baptist in that famous painting on the Isenheim altarpiece, a painting of the crucifixion, Alan would always have pointed away from himself to Jesus. So Alan might have said we should remember not him, but what he taught. He was first and foremost a teacher. Indeed, when Judy and I visited Alan and Phyllis in their home a week ago yesterday, he was making hopeful plans to return to the classroom before the end of the semester, to deliver, he said, just a couple more lectures. It was not to be. But his life goes on teaching us. What Alan taught was inseparable from the life of the man who taught it. He was a man of unfailing generosity, integrity, wisdom, and sly, self-deprecating humor. And one of the most important things Alan taught us is this: how to die well. He taught us not only by writing a moving and elegant book entitled The Christian Art of Dying. He taught us also through his own life and death how to practice that difficult art. Of the many things we could learn from Alan, we should learn the importance of our scripture texts today, with their key themes of lament and hope. Phyllis was telling me just before the service that Alan believed that Psalm 22 always belonged in funeral services. So we begin with lament. My God, why have you forsaken me? In the unfolding drama of God's rescue of a broken world, the anguished prayer of the psalmist became also the cry of Jesus as he died on the cross. And so, by entering into the full depths of human suffering, Jesus shows that faithfulness to God does not preclude lament, rather, it includes it. It even requires it. Faithfulness to God requires lament. Lament is not just a way of blurting out sorrow and despair. Rather, the cry of lament grows from the deep conviction that the God who made the world has chosen us in love. It is God who has instilled our hope of healing and rescue from the power of death. God is the one whom our ancestors trusted and he delivered them. But death is the last enemy that seeks to destroy God's good creation. And so, in the face of suffering and death, it is a good and right thing for us to cry out in protest. Lament is a way of calling in the midst of our pain to the very God who promised to make all things whole. And here is the deepest mystery. The God to whom we cry has mysteriously shared our suffering. As Alan put it in his book, the ones who lament may also know that God does not neglect their cry, that Christ weeps in their tears. That's why, as Alan said in another place, we can give thanks to God that we don't always have to give thanks to God. Our loss is real. Death is a genuine cause for grief. We don't sugarcoat it. We don't too hastily speak of heavenly bliss. The Apostle Paul put it this way in writing to the church in Thessalonica. He writes, "We don't want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope." He didn't mean that grieving is wrong. Rather, he means that we should grieve precisely as those who do have hope. Those who, in light of the resurrection of Jesus, await his coming and bringing again from the dead, those who have died. And that's the way in which our community gathers here today. We grieve the loss of our teacher, friend, and brother. His family grieves the loss of a beloved husband and father and grandfather. But with aching hearts, we also look, as did the psalmist, to the God who has dominion over the world and who will not despise or abhor the affliction of the afflicted. God will hear when we cry to him. And so that leads us to turn to our second text. The reading from the book of Revelation offers us not lament, but hope. In the ending of Revelation, we're given a visionary glimpse, a preview of God's answer to our cry. It's not a picture of disembodied souls finding individual immortality, but it's a picture of the healing of all creation. It's a picture of God's making all things new and consoling those who have cried out to him. Listen again. The dwelling of God is with humankind. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." That's a picture of what Alan loved to call God's good future. It was a characteristic theme of his theological writing and lecturing, God's good future. He never tired of speaking about God's good future, and he trusted deeply in the power of God to make all things well in the end. Why? Because death does not have the last word. In the resurrection of Jesus, God has already spoken the word that overcomes death. In the opening pages of Alan's book on the art of dying, he wrote about his purpose for writing a book on such a difficult topic in light of the illness that had brought him face to face with his own mortality. Here's what he wrote, quote, "If I was going to die, I wanted it to be my death. The final chapter in my story and not a footnote in a research report someday. I wanted it to be a faithful dying, a dying worthy of one who cherishes the gospel. I hope my voice in this book is that of a mortal theologian, a man who knows that he will die and who believes that the last word belongs to God." a man who cherishes both the Christian tradition and life. I also hope that my voice can bring both comfort and courage to other mortal Christians and confidence to the Christian communities who are called to care for them. End quote. Alan, you did indeed bring comfort, courage, and confidence to your mortal brothers and sisters, both through your voice and through your consistent example of following Jesus and remembering Jesus. And because of your witness, we trust more deeply that the last word belongs to God. The last word belongs to the one who promises to make all things new.
Please be seated. Let us pray. O God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all your servants who, having lived this life in faith, now live with you eternally. Especially, we thank you for your servant, Alan Del Verhey, a child of the covenant, whose baptism is now made complete in death. We thank you that Alan was your faithful and loving servant for 68 years, a teacher and a scholar, a writer and a speaker, a theologian and a preacher, a game player and a sports fan. We thank you that you hemmed him in behind and before with a loving family and called him to love and care for them all as son, brother, husband, father, uncle, and grandfather. When you wove Alan together in the depths of the earth, when you saw his unformed body, when you ordained his days, you made Alan to be a person who was positive, optimistic, joy-filled, gentle, honest, and trustworthy. Someone who never complained, but who rather who lived every day to its fullest, all the way to the end. And you gifted Alan with a way with words, a love for reading and writing, a deep faith in you, and a passion for teaching and preaching your word, which he believed with every fiber of his being, using his words to instruct and convey a genuine care for his students. We thank you that his words and his instruction will live on through the numerous articles and books that he published during his lifetime. You gifted Alan with a childlike spirit that enabled him to enjoy pickup basketball games, wiffle ball, puzzles, pickle, smoking his pipe, and riding around town when it was 50 degrees in his windy car convertible. We thank you that you gifted Alan with such a zest for life and a determination to live his life well until he died, as a gentleman and a scholar, as a devoted husband to Phyllis for 48 years, and as a very proud father and grandfather. As you ordained his days, as you wrote them in your book, you appointed Alan as one of your tzadikim, one of your righteous ones, whom you placed in our midst to remind us of what true goodness looks like and to justify our human purpose before your eyes, that we might glorify you and enjoy you forever. Alan was one of your tzadikim, your living saints, who claimed he could hear the bread talk when he broke it, and it said to him, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this, do love, do mercy, do kindness, do walk with me in humility." And so we thank you that there is nowhere that Alan can go from your presence. If he rises on the wings of the dawn or settles on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide him. As he would say, you are as close to him as his eyelashes. And so we rejoice that you have received Alan into your eternal shalom, where he now enjoys life everlasting and life abundant, experiencing your healing presence and unending grace. Help us who remain, Lord, to listen to your still small voice, trusting you to shepherd us through the remainder of our journeys. Help us to trust that in the darkness, even there your light shines bright. And bring us at last with you and all the saints to dwell in your lovely house, surrounded by your goodness and mercy forever and ever, through Jesus Christ, our loving Redeemer, who taught us as his disciples to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Using the opening question of the Heidelberg Catechism that was so formative for Alan's life, let us stand and say what we believe together. What is your only comfort in life and in death? That I am not my own, but belong body and soul, in life and in death, to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all my sins with his precious blood, and has set me free from the tyranny of the devil. He also watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation. Because I belong to him, Christ, by his Holy Spirit, assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him.
Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Alan Dale Verhey. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy and into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints of light.
Thank you.
On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. Remember?" In life and in death, in life beyond death, we belong to God. If we rise on the wings of the dawn or settle on the far side of the sea, even there God's hand will hold us fast. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance to you and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, go in peace. Amen.